Okay, good morning everyone. So today we are here to discuss about action angle variable method. So this is the part of a discussion in related to second module. Okay, there you have already studied about Hamilton-Jacobi method and you have applied that to understand and evaluate different problems like harmonic oscillator and Kepler problem, and also you have done our assignment on to work out on the case of Schrodinger wave equation. How do we represent, how do we evaluate these three problems using Hamilton-Jacobian method that you has already have been experienced and you have well known about that. And what we will be introducing about action angle variable method is that this is one much more a simple method where you can actually utilize in order to understand the frequency of a measurement without going further, this you can understand without going much detail to find the solution of a particular problem. That is, you can find the frequency of a problem without doing much rigorous solution of that particular issues. Like you can find the frequency of a harmonic oscillator or a frequency of any other cases without doing much rigorous solution. Normally when you address Hamilton-Jacobian method and all, you have to do a proper method to solve all the solution of that equation of motion corresponding to that. Then you finally ending up to understand what is the frequency of that particular case. So in action angle variable method, you can find the frequency of that measurement without going for the detailed solution. So what is the main benefit compared to Hamilton-Jacobian method is that here it is a very simple procedure, very easy to solve any mechanical problem. So basically action angle variable method is a procedure or a method to solve mechanical problems and one of the greatest advantage compared to the Hamilton-Jacobian is that it is very easy easy to solve the using this method. And if you consider any mechanical problems, any classical mechanical problem, you can identify the frequency. Okay, you can identify the frequency of that mechanism can be identified without going or without finding can be identified without finding the exact solution of that motion or that problem. Okay, that is the greatest advantage of this action angle variable method. And further, even you can find a frequency of a periodic motion without solving that problem. Okay, you can find mainly it is addressing in order to identify the frequency of periodic motion. Okay, periodic motion without solving the problem. Okay, so that is the main advantage of this action angle variable method, where we have two variables. Basically when you consider, normally if you consider any representation, while you consider in Hamilton-Jacobian method, you have taken two cases, alpha and beta over there, where alpha is representing the new coordinate and beta is, it will be reverse. In maybe you have taken a reverse transform, that is beta is representing a new coordinate, that is qi, and alpha is representing a new momenta. Okay, so like you have been taken in that case, so when you consider the Hamilton-Jacobian method, in that case you would have taken alpha and beta, where alpha is representing the momentum corresponding to that is a new momentum corresponding to any coordinate representation, and beta is representing the new coordinate representation q. Okay, So this is how you normally represented from when you consider the Hamiltonian-Jacobian method. But in a case of action angle variable method, there are two variables basically. One is called action variable. Another one we used to call as angle variable. And combining these two, we can actually find the frequency of any representation. So what, let me introduce what is action variable is that. Action variable is represented in terms of Ji. Okay. So this is how we represent action variable. So this action variable has a dependency on a function that is called alpha. Okay. So this is Ji is equal to basically Ji is depend on alpha 1, alpha 2, alpha 3 and alpha up to n. So this is a function actually depending on alpha. So we can rigorously say that with all values of alpha, this action variable is depending on Ji. So the important aspect of this Ji is that if you don't know the moment of any variable, still you can find the solution of corresponding that problem. Because why do we say that? Because is that because Ji is basically, so I have just said that action variable is depending on a parameter that is alpha, that is alpha 1, alpha 2, alpha 3 and alpha n, and also we can say that alpha 1, alpha 2, alpha 3, it is an independent function. Okay, so this is an independent function. So here we don't need to find the momentum. Okay, no need to find the momentum here. So that is the main advantage of this problem. Momentum here. So we have an independent function of alpha. So Ji is a dependent function of alpha, and alpha 1, alpha 2, alpha 3 is the independent functions with respect to that. And here we have also, we can say that what is basically Ji means. Mathematically, how we represent Ji? Ji is simply, we can say that it is a term, we can say that Ji is equal to a closed integral of Pi, capital Pi and dQi. Okay, this is a representation of Ji, closed integral Pi dQi is the corresponding representation, as you can see over here. Now if you just represent Ji, the action variable, is in terms of a closed integral Pi dQi, if you just integrate this representation, you can actually get the value of Ji. Now what I do here is that I'll be just representing that in generalized coordinate representation, that is generated function representation, as a generating function representation, that is f is equal to s, and that is equal, and you are familiar with the equation w minus alpha t, where w is a function of what? It is a function of q and alpha. Okay, it is a function of q and alpha, and also you need that, you know that, and the momentum representation p will be, in that case it is dou f by dou q, and rather, or you can say that that is dou s by dou q, or if you are want to represent that in terms of alpha, okay, then you can rather, it is, you can represent in terms of dou w by dou q I. Okay, this way you can represent the p value over here. Now if I introduce, because we said that we are not going to find the momenta here, so what we do are, we will be having a function that is in terms of w. W is a function of a old coordinate q and alpha here. Okay, so let me just introduce what is Ji then. So Ji is equal to, we have closed integral p dqi. So the action variable can be represented in this fashion. So this is the equation corresponding to that. Just note down that. And now what I do is that I will be just keeping Ji is equal to, what is p over here? P is dou w by dou qi. So I can introduce that into the equation. So that is dou w by dou qi dqi. Okay, this is what we are getting over here. And I said that what is Ji means. Ji is a function that is depends on alpha 1, alpha 2 and alpha 3, right? So Ji is a function, basically it's depending on alpha 1, and alpha 2 and etc. up to alpha n. Okay, and we know that mathematically there is a representation when ji is depending on alpha, then we can say that alpha is depending on ji. So we can either represent it as alpha is equal to, alpha is a function of ji, j1, j2 up to jn. Okay, so this is a mathematical relation. We can just simply say that when ji is a function of alpha, it is clear that alpha is a function of j1 also. Okay, so that we can simply represent it like this. And now by taking this equation into consideration, we also having a representation, that is the w. Okay, w is we used to call as a Hamilton characteristic function, that I'll be explaining later on. So w is a function of what? It is q and alpha. And we also having ji is a function of alpha I. Okay, ji is a function of alpha I. Now what I can say that if this is the condition, then now I can transform this entire equation in this fashion, that is I can find out a Hamilton characteristic function. So I'll be introducing what is that characteristic function. So we'll be having a Hamilton characteristic function that is of the form in terms of w. Okay, that is of the form w, which is equal to w of qi comma ji. Okay, so we have introduced a Hamilton characteristic function w. W is equal to what? W is equal to w of qi. W is a function of the old coordinate qi and a function of action variable ji. Okay, so we got a function, because how do we get this? Because ji is a function of alpha I and alpha is a function of j. Okay, so they can replace this alpha by j then. Okay, so I have just replaced the alpha by j, then I'll be getting w is equal to w of function of qi ji, and this function we used to call as Hamilton characteristic function, because this is very important, because we have introduced a Hamilton characteristic function, which is a function of qi. Qi means it is an old coordinate representation, because we know that qi is an old coordinate, which is actually can transform to a new coordinate capital qi. Similarly, like pi can be transforming to a new momentum like this. Okay, this I will be looking to later on to discussion. So qi means normally representing a old coordinate, right, that you already have studied, and this one will be a new coordinate system. Okay, corresponding to that. So what we have introduced here is that we have introduced a Hamilton characteristic function w, that is a function of qi and ji. Okay, so now we just given an idea of action variable, and action variable is simply, if you represent ji is equal to closed integral pi dqi, that we understood, and there is we introduced a Hamilton characteristic function also. Now let me introduce you what is angle variable is. So now we already said about angle variable. Okay, now already we said about action variable, now we will be saying about angle variable. So angle variable, normally we do represent this in terms of omega I. This is this one is w and this one is omega. Okay, do not be confused. So the angle variable normally will represent in terms of omega I, which is we call as angle variable. Okay, generally this one is a generalized coordinate conjugate. Okay, this is a generalized representation of, which is generalized conjugate coordinate representation. It is similar like that. Okay, so it is similar like a generalized conjugate coordinate. So omega I is equal to, which we call as angle variable. Then what is angle variable omega is? So omega I is equal to what? It is, we can represent in terms of Hamilton characteristic function. So that I can represent it, dou w divided by dou j I is the action variable here. Okay, dou w by dou j I, where j I is the action variable. So if you differentiate with respect to action variable, if you differentiate the characteristic function with respect to the action variable, you will be getting the angle variable representation over here. Okay, and now let me introduce a case. We know that when we have a new coordinate system, that is qi, okay, and if you are taking the qi dot of that, okay, so we are taking the derivative of a generalized coordinate or a new coordinate system capital qi, which is equal to, how do we represent, which we can represent in terms of, if you have a Hamiltonian, that is h dash by dou p I. Okay, it is capital P I. Okay, capital P I. So what is h dash? H dash is a new Hamiltonian. Okay, corresponding to a new coordinate system. Okay, it is a new Hamiltonian. That's why I represent it in terms of h dash. So it's a new Hamiltonian. So Q I dash is equal to what? Which is dou h dash by dou P I. Okay, now let me introduce that I can represent pi is a function. Pi I can replace here by, how do I replace? Dou h dash by dou j, dou j I. Okay, dou j I. So I will be just replacing the momentum part with an action variable. So dou h dash divided by dou j I is the corresponding representation. Then if you take qi dash, and qi dash is what? Qi dash will be your corresponding action variable, sorry, angle variable. If you are taking the angle variable dot, omega I dot is your dou h dash by dou j I. So from that, what we will be getting is that when you represent omega I dot, that is omega I dot equal to what? It is dou h dash by dou j I. Okay, so it is equal to, we'll be getting the corresponding frequency. Okay, if you take the value omega I dot, we'll be gonna get a frequency corresponding to that, and this frequency, that is, we are saying about this frequency, can be easily identified using this method. So this is a frequency representation, nu I, and nu I is a frequency here, frequency of any motion. So it is, if you have an Hamiltonian corresponding to that, if you have an Hamiltonian corresponding to any motion or a problem, then you can just differentiate with respect to the angle variable, sorry, action variable, then you will be getting the corresponding representation of the frequency representation. You can find it out here. Okay, so this is new frequency, new I is equal to what? It is dou h dash by dou j I. Okay, so this is how the frequency you have to find out from action angle variable method. Okay, we will be understanding by taking an example, by considering an example what we have done so far. So how do we apply this action angle variable and action angle variable method in order to address a problem, that will come to discussion. Before that, let me just see you one more point into the discussion, that is, now if you represent omega I, so if you want to represent omega I, so omega I is what, which we can simply say that is vi into t plus a function beta, because you will be getting a function if you just take a differentiation of this one. Okay, sorry, integration of this one, you will be getting is that omega I, that is the angle variable, can be represented in terms of frequency into t plus beta is the corresponding representation regarding that. And also we know that the action angle variable is a function of what? It is a function of omega I, is a function of q I and j I. okay, it is a function of q and j. And now if this is the relation we having, if this is the relation we having, because the angle variable is relating, it is a function of the old coordinate and the action variable. And if you have this relation, we can also have a relation, that is qi is equal to, is a function of qi of omega I and ji. So what I did here, is that if you have a old coordinate system, that is a function of action variable and angle variable and action variable, okay, this is j and this is omega. So if you can say that angle variable is a function of qi and ji, now we can say that the coordinate, the old coordinate qi, is a function of angle variable omega I and action variable ji representation. So this is how you can simply represent that in terms of angle variable and action variable representation. Okay, so this is a brief introduction about action angle variable. Now you will be getting more understanding about this by applying this method into a problem. Okay, so for that we'll be addressing a problem, that is about harmonic oscillator problem. How do we find the solution of a harmonic oscillator problem, and how do we find the frequency corresponding to that? So that will be our next step to do that. So let me go to that. So now we'll take an example of harmonic oscillator and find the solution of harmonic oscillator. By this action angle method, okay. Action angle variable method, okay. So for that, what we do is that we said that alpha is a constant, okay. It is an independent function. Alpha is a constant, we said, and now we said that where the action variable is depending on that values of alpha, alpha 1, alpha 2, alpha 3, etc. up to alpha n. So now we know that for a harmonic oscillator, the Hamiltonian H is what? Hamiltonian H is equal to alpha. Okay, let me just say that it's a Hamiltonian is a constant, right? So we take it as Hamiltonian is equal to alpha. Then what is the Hamiltonian regarding that? That is equal to p square by 2m plus, I can say that, half m omega square q square. Let me represent it in terms of the old coordinate q and the momenta representation over here. And we know that what is p? P is the momentum representation. So from this representation, we'll be getting an idea, because if you just represent that in terms of alpha, so we'll have, if you extract p from this equation, what you'll be getting? That is, you'll be getting the value is 2m alpha, you can multiply this 2 here, minus m square omega square q square, like you will be getting the representation corresponding to p. P will be root 2m alpha minus m square omega square q square. Okay, now what we know is that what is action variable is. So our action variable corresponding to this, how do we represent in the equation corresponding to action variable j? So let me just say that j, so that is closed integral p dq, okay. So which is equal to what? Which is equal to closed integral p, already we know that is root 2m alpha minus m square omega square q square dq, okay. And now we know to know, we need to know what is dq is. So let me just directly introduce the q value here. So here the q value will be, so let I will be taking, let q equal to 2 alpha, sorry, is this is okay, 2 alpha divided by m omega square sine theta is the value of q. let me just take the solution of Q will be root 2 alpha by m omega square sin theta. Maybe you have taken the similar solution for your discussion earlier also. So what will be dq here? If dq, then in that case will be, it is 2 alpha by m omega square. Okay, so that will be cos theta. Okay, cos theta d theta will be coming for that. Okay, so now I can substitute dq in this equation, so that j is equal to what? J is equal to closed integral root 2m alpha minus m square omega square q square. Q square. So I can substitute one more term over here. That is, q is what? Q is 2 alpha m omega square sin theta. So what will be my q square? Q square I can substitute as 2 alpha divided by m omega square sin square theta. This is, I just represented because q is root 2 alpha m omega square sin theta. My 2 alpha by m omega square will be 2 alpha by m omega square sin square theta representation I will be having. Okay. And into dq we have to represent. Dq is what? It is 2 alpha divided by m omega square cos theta d theta. Okay. So that is my j over here. And this, when you consider this representation, so we'll be having okay, one sec. Okay, so when you reduce, you can actually cancel m omega square and m omega square here, and what you'll be getting is that you'll be getting the function corresponding to that, that is a closed integral 2 root 2m alpha, okay, root 2m alpha cos square theta root 2 alpha m omega square d theta, like you can reduce, because there will be 1 minus sine square theta will be representation, you can find it out here. Then if you take root 2m alpha outside, there will be 1 minus cos square theta, then you can be having 2 representation, cos theta will be there, and then you will be having cos square theta representation, because you can take a 1 minus sine square theta and root m alpha outside. 1 minus sine square theta means what? It is cos square theta, cos theta, cos theta if you take it from outside the root. Okay, so then cos theta and this cos theta will be there, then you will be having cos square theta root 2 alpha by m omega square d theta representation will be, you will be left out while solving this problem. Okay, and now what do we, I will be having is that, so if I just follow it out, so I can take root 2 alpha m omega square is there, so root m and root m and will m will be cancelling, and we will be having omega square will be there, so this I can represent it as 2 alpha by omega square, 2 alpha by omega square I can take it outside, and now the integration will be on cos square theta d theta, cos square theta d theta. Okay, and now we know that we can represent this cos square theta in terms of 1 minus cos 2 theta representation. Since it's a closed integral, so we can say that the limit will be 0 to 2 pi, right? So 2 alpha by omega square, this can be, limit will be 0 to 2 pi, and cos square theta I can represent it as 1 minus cos 2 theta divided by 2 d theta. Okay, so if I do represent like this, okay, one second, there will be no square over here, this will be also omega square. Okay, 2 alpha by omega. So I'll be having 2 alpha by 2 omega. This 2 I 1 by 2 I can take it outside. So that is 2 omega. Then there will be 1 minus, right? So there will be a theta representation. If you integrate, there will be theta. Then you have to apply theta 0 to 2 pi over theta minus cos 2 theta. You can, while you integrating, you will be having sin 2 theta divided by 2. Okay. And that is when you apply 0 to 2 pi will be there. Okay. So this is how we do evaluate that function. And what finally what will be left out? What we are evaluating here? We are evaluating j here. So j will be what? So what will be finally will be left out will be when you apply 2 pi 0 to 2 pi on sine 2 theta, we know that this function will go for 0. Okay. And what will be left out will be only case this alpha by omega into 2 pi will be the corresponding representation will be having. Okay. That is j equal to what? 2 pi alpha divided by omega. 2 pi alpha divided by omega is the corresponding representation. We know that what is omega is. So before that, let me just say that j is what now? J is 2 pi alpha by omega, and alpha equal to, I can represent as in terms of j, that is omega j divided by 2 pi. Okay, clear? So now also we know that what is alpha. Okay, we said that initially we have said that h is equal to alpha, that is Hamiltonian h is equal to what? It is equal to alpha. Okay, that we already said. So now we know that the frequency nu equal to, we have represented that is dou h by dou j. It is a differentiation of Hamiltonian with respect to the action variable dou j. So what is h here? So that is dou alpha by dou j. So in order to get the frequency nu, so we'll be having frequency nu equal to what? Nu equal to dou alpha by dou j, that is equal to, because we are having alpha over here, right? So alpha is equal to omega j by 2 pi. So if you just differentiate this function, what you will be getting? The frequency nu will be equal to omega by 2 pi. Okay. So the frequency nu is equal to what? It is omega by 2 pi will be getting. So we got a frequency already here, right? Now what is this omega? This omega is not our angle variable. This omega is what? This omega is a okay. This omega is, we know that when for a harmonic oscillator, for an harmonic oscillator, omega is equal to what? It is root k by m. So we'll get nu equal to 1 by 2 pi root k by m, because we already has taken omega. So omega is root k by m, and we got a frequency of harmonic oscillator by using this action variable method. Okay, so this is how the action variable method will be working. Okay, so we got an idea of how do we address a particular problem like harmonic oscillator problem, where you have to take the momentum p and you have to take the q, and that you can actually convert into fashion of j, then you can actually find the frequency in terms of dou h by dou j representation, where we have taken the consideration of alpha term, which is equal to Hamiltonian representation. So this is how the action variable method work for a case of a particular problem. So this is a very simple representation. You want to know only a basic idea of the integration method to do this problem, where you want to take the closed integral of p dq, and you have to find out the p and q, and if you introduce that into the problem, it is easy to get the frequency without doing the rigorous solution of the motion corresponding to that problem. Okay, so that is about harmonic oscillator case. So this is one of the example I'll be introducing here, and now I'll be going to a different section. That is a very small section related to a canonical representation of this problem. So that we will do by here. Okay. So let me just go to a new section now. That is, how do we represent this action variable method in terms of infinitesimal canonical transformations? Okay, so which is called as simply we used to represent as ICT. Okay, infinitesimal canonical transformation. We know that infinitesimal means very small change. We have seen when we have discussed about Euler's angle and all. Infinitesimal means very small change in rotation or any parameter. Okay, so we know that in normal case, when you do represent any equation where we will be having, for example, we know that qi is transforming to a new coordinate qi. Okay, so we have a representation qi. Qi is the old coordinate which is transforming into a new coordinate capital qi. Okay, this is, we call it as identity transformation, because this you would have already studied in your discussions before. Okay, so this is called as identity transformation. That is a old coordinate is transforming to a new coordinate, and if that transformation is happening, so how do we transform a qi to q or capital qi? There should be some small change in any variable, so any motion, so any movement that is actually leading to a new coordinate system or a new coordinate. So simply this part of the discussion we can simply extend it like that. Qi, capital qi, is actually what? It is small qi, that is a old coordinate, plus a small infinitesimal change, delta qi. So that infinitesimal change I do represent here. So very small change. Okay, so it's an infinitesimal. So we have a new coordinate that is equal to qi plus delta qi here. And similarly, a capital qi pi, it's a new momenta. A new momenta can be represented as in terms of small pi plus delta pi. Okay, delta pi, these are the two equations we will be having now. You just keep a note of this equation. Capital qi is equal to qi plus delta qi, and capital pi, where capital q and capital p is a new coordinate and new momenta here. Okay, so it is pi plus delta pi. So just keep it as the equation number one over here. Okay, now we know that if you consider a generating function, okay, so if you consider a generating function, for example, let me introduce a generating function. So that is in terms of f. Okay, so a generating function f, normally we do represent it like this. So it is epsilon qi pi. Okay, sorry, let me represent it properly. So it will be a epsilon qi capital pi. Just note of this one. Here it is capital pi plus there is a function epsilon this is a summation, okay? So this is epsilon g q capital P, okay, where g is a function, this one is a capital again, okay, capital P, it's not small p, this one is a small q, okay. So this epsilon is a infinitesimal change, this is change representing a infinitesimal change, and g is a function of q and p, g is a function of q and p. So we can represent this epsilon is a infinitesimal small change. So we have a generating function f sigma qi pi plus epsilon g q p like this, and we know that the generating function normally will be working in the case that is qi is transforming to capital qi and small pi is transforming to capital pi, and we had a representation. For example, we have a second order generating function f2, it will be normally will be equal to, be represented as q and capital P like this, okay. So we had a same representation over here, but we, in addition to that, there is a small infinitesimal function in terms of q and p as a function of g, also we are represented here. It is similar like the qi here, okay, where g is a function of q and p, okay. Small change in g has been addressed here. So this is a generating function we will be having here. Now what do I introduce is that, so we have to say that p is what, in this case p will be, we can actually represent, if this is a condition, p we can say that it is dou f2 by dou qi, okay, and qi will be equal to what, it is dou f2 by dou capital pi, okay. So this is how we represent the corresponding representation of the equation, capital pi is equal to dou f2 by dou qi, capital qi is equal to dou f2 by dou pi, okay. So this is a capital P, just keep a note of capital P and all, because it should not be confused with later on. And what do I can say is that, when if we have a representation like this, then this capital Pi is equal to small pi plus, there is a small change in epsilon is there, so with respect to g. So here g we are having a change, small change in g is there, so which I can take it as delta g. So that is, I can represent that is dou g by dou qi, okay. And similarly, capital qi I can represent it as small qi plus epsilon dou g by dou capital pi, okay. Now what I will be having is that, if you consider this particular equation, then we'll have capital qi minus small qi is equal to what, it is epsilon, sorry, it is epsilon dou g by dou capital pi, right. And similarly, we have the representation corresponding to the, and similarly we have the representation corresponding to capital pi minus small pi is equal to what, it is epsilon dou g by dou qi, okay, dou g by dou qi will be there, okay. Now this I can, this equation I can further represent it as delta qi is equal to, delta qi is equal to what, it is epsilon dou g by, because qi minus qi means delta qi, so that is epsilon do g by what? Do capital I. And similarly here, so here I'll be doing a small rearrangement, that is pi to pi. Okay, so I'll be having, in order to get a delta pi, so I'll be having delta pi is equal to what? It will be minus epsilon dou g by dou qi. Okay, so there are two equations I'll be getting from here, that is delta qi, the infinitesimal change in new old coordinate, is equal to epsilon dou g by dou capital pi, and delta pi is equal to minus epsilon dou g by dou qi dot. I'll be having two representation over here. Okay, so from that we got a two equation corresponding to that. Now let me assume that there is a condition corresponding. This equation is very important. You just note down delta qi is equal to epsilon dou g by dou pi, and delta pi is equal to minus epsilon dou g by dou qi representation. Okay, now we know that we just take capital pi minus small pi is delta pi. Okay, it's a very small quantity. And in that case, we can say that capital Pi is equal to what? Small Pi. So in that case, we can actually replace delta Qi is equal to what? Epsilon dou G by dou small Pi representation. Okay? If this difference delta Pi is very small, and then in that case, you can actually replace this new coordinate system by old coordinate system. That is delta qi is equal to epsilon dou g by dou pi. Okay, so we'll be getting the equation corresponding to that. So delta qi is equal to epsilon dou g by dou pi can be replaced. Now let me just take a few examples. How do we apply this representation? What is this delta qi and delta pi? It is a very infinitesimal change. So we will be getting, what we will be basically getting is that, so we'll get an idea of what is the infinitesimal change in the coordinate system. Okay, so that is actually what is this infinitesimal change, role of this infinitesimal change? By changing this infinitesimal rotation, we can actually change a coordinate from a old coordinate system to a new coordinate system. So that is what we have said initially in the condition, because when there is a small infinitesimal change, this qi will be transforming to what? It's a new coordinate system. And there is a small infinitesimal change in the momenta, then the old momenta will be transforming to a new momenta, that is capital Pi. So what we'll be getting is that by evaluating this, we'll be getting an idea of that is what is that infinitesimal change. So that we'll be getting idea by taking epsilon dou g by dou pi representation over here. So let me just take an example. How do we take this representation? How do we useful for how this will be useful for analyze any problem, any condition? So that we will analyze the next way. So let me just take an example for here. Okay, so let me taking, let g equal to h. Okay, let g equal to h and epsilon is equal to dt. G is equal to h and epsilon equal to dt. And now we know that what is delta pi then. So what is delta pi? So delta pi will be equal to what? It is minus epsilon dou g by dou qi. Okay, that is equal to minus dt dou h by dou qi. Okay, minus dt dou h by dou qi will be getting this. And also when you represent dou pi because we know that what is pi dot is, pi dot is equal to what? It is equal to minus dot h by, okay, this should be small, right? Okay, pi dot will be equal to minus dou h by dou qi. Okay, so we can replace this equation by dp then. So that is delta pi will be equal to what? So this will be equal to dou h by dou qi is equal to minus dou h by dou qi will be pi dot. So that is dt into, okay, okay, dp into pi dot will be there corresponding to that representation. Now what will be having, what is delta pi is equal to? So delta pi is equal to what? Dt into, what is pi dot means? Pi dot means dpi divided by dt, right? So from that representation we will be getting an idea, is that delta pi is equal to what? dpi. Now like we will be getting the first representation, okay? So what will be the representation is that when p has a small change, p plus dp happening when time t equal to t plus dt, when time changes is varying by a small change dt, p is actually converting, small p is p plus dp. Okay, there will be a small change in momentum you can expect when there is a small change in dt. That is a representation we have here. So the infinitesimal change pi will be equal to dpi. That is, we are getting an idea here. And similarly, if you do the delta qi here, so delta qi is equal to what? It is epsilon dou g by dou pi. When you do that, that is dt dou h by dou pi. Okay, so that is, we will be getting is that dt is equal to what? This is qi dot. This will be a qi dot representation. Okay, then what you will be getting basically here is that you will be getting the value, that is delta qi. Delta qi is equal to dt dqi divided by dt, that is equal to dqi. Okay, so what we will be getting is that in both condition the infinitesimal change is equal to the differential change. Okay, so dqi, so you can change, take both are equal, the infinitesimal change is equal to the differential changes happening over here. That is the same scenario that we observed in the earlier case as well. Here also delta pi is equal to dpi that we are getting over here. Okay, so this is how normally this delta qi and delta py will be evaluating for this representation, and we got an idea of how do this representation is working out here. And now what I do here is that this is how we represent the canonical transformation, infinitesimal change in a canonical transformation, and I can take this representation into a Poisson bracket representation. So for that, so this infinitesimal canonical representation ICT now will be representing in terms of Poisson's bracket representation. For that I'll be taking again the case of a generating function which is f equal to sigma qi pi plus epsilon g as a function of qi and capital pi. Okay, and where we having delta qi equal to what? That is epsilon dou g by dou capital pi, and delta pi is equal to, delta pi is equal to minus epsilon dou g by dou q I. Okay, so by taking this equation into consideration, we can actually represent that into a Poisson bracket condition. So for that, I'll be introducing a function that is x. So I'll be introducing a function x. So where x is a function of q, p, and t. So it's a function of q, p, t. Now if you represent the delta x of this one, so which has a function of delta x is equal to sigma dou x by dou q I into delta q I plus dou x by dou p I into delta p I plus there will be another function that is dou x by dou t into delta t representation. Okay, and now if I consider delta t is tends to 0, so I can neglect this term, right? Then that condition, so then I'll be having a representation that is delta x is equal to epsilon. I'll be having only this representation now. So that is dou x by dou q I delta q I plus dou x by dou p I delta p I. Okay, and which is equal to, now we know that what is delta q I and delta p I is. So I can substitute that into the equation, that is dou x by dou q I into epsilon dou g by dou capital P I minus dou x by dou P I, because this minus is coming from minus epsilon dou g by dou q I representation. So I can substitute that into the equation, right? So I'll be having the equation like this. Okay, one second. Oh, sorry. Okay, so delta x I have represented like this. And now I can take the take out the epsilon outside. So epsilon into sigma dou x by dou q I dou g by dou p I, right? Minus dou x by dou p I dou g by dou q I. So this is a Poisson bracket representation, right? That is in terms of x and g. Okay, so I can just say that delta x is equal to what? Epsilon into a Poisson bracket x g, or capital X or small x, that is only a convenience. So it is a representation of delta x is a representation of delta x is equal to epsilon into x g. So you can just represent this small change in x, that is in terms of infinitesimal constant epsilon or infinitesimal change epsilon with respect to xg. So what it is representing, so delta x is equal to what? Is an infinitesimal change in this Poisson bracket. So from that you can actually get the delta x value corresponding to that. What is x over here? X is any function, that is a function depending on q, p, and t. So x is a function that is depending on a q, p, and t. If you introduce that, you can get a basic idea of this representation. Now, so this is how the Poisson bracket representation of the ICT, infinitesimal change canonical transformation equation. And I'll be introducing a small example here. Okay, small example means I'll be just giving few values corresponding to epsilon and q. So let me just give that epsilon is equal to dt. Okay, epsilon is equal to dt and x is equal to q. Okay, now if you introduce that, then what is delta q will be? Delta q will be, because x is replaced by q, so delta q will be equal to what? it is dt into qg. Okay, and g equal to what? Now if I just introduce g equal to h, okay, it's an Hamiltonian. Now we know that there is a relation we having, that is f h is equal to, f there is a generating function or some function, f and h is a Poisson bracket, and this we can represent as f dot. Okay, so if you take a Poisson bracket like this, f and h, then it is a function, f dot will be the resulting value. And now if you do the similar representation here, that is dt qh, where g is h, so dt qh we can replace by this Poisson bracket, and what we will be getting here is that delta q is equal to dt into, if qh is the representation, and if you have similarly like that, qh means what? It is q dot. Okay, and now we'll having q dot over here. Okay, delta q is equal to dt into q dot representation like there. And now what is delta q equal to? Dt into dq by dt, right? So what we'll be getting? So we'll be getting dq representation over here. Okay, so that is what we are getting. We will be getting that delta q is equal to dq. Okay, so we'll be getting the infinitesimal change, because we earlier we proved that infinitesimal change will be equal to the differential change dq. Okay, we are getting the same result by considering the Poisson bracket also. And similarly, in similar fashion, you can do that. Similarly, you can do epsilon equal to dt. Okay, and you can take x is equal to p. Okay, and g equal to h. Okay, x is equal to p, g equal to h. If you can just substitute that into the equation, then what you will be getting is that delta p is equal to what? Delta p is equal to dt into ph. Okay, like you will be getting the equation, and what is that? It means dt equal to p dot. Okay, and again what we will be getting? Dt equal to dp by dt. Okay, and we will be having the resulting value will be what? Delta p equal to dp. So by using Poisson bracket also, you can sort out the infinitesimal change, you can also identify here also. Okay, so you will be getting the narration corresponding to the same. Okay, so in summary, what we have discussed today is that today we have introduced a new method, that is action angle variable method. Using that, one can identify the frequency of a problem without going or without finding the exact solution of that problem. Okay, that is the one thing we are introducing, that is JI in terms of JI as the representation of action, and where omega I is the representation of the angle variable over there. So then we have introduced the corresponding equation, and we have find out the an example corresponding to that. Then we have represented that equation. Okay, that is the infinitesimal canonical transformation, that is in terms of canonical transformation we find it out first, then we find it out the infinitesimal canonical transformation, that is in terms of a Poisson bracket representation. How do we represent? That is in terms of Poisson bracket representation, because by both method what we will be getting, the basic idea is delta q is equal to the differential change dq. So simply you can actually change a coordinate system from one system to another system by a infinitesimal change delta qi and delta pi. So from that you will be getting the, you can very easily quantify that representation. Okay, so if you have the momenta or if you have the Hamiltonian, then you can actually quantify the infinitesimal change by using this infinitesimal canonical transformation equations and these transformation representations. Okay, That's what we have identified so far in students' discussion. So with that discussion, we came to an end of our classical mechanics discussion.